Well, good evening, everybody. It's so wonderful to see you here tonight. Welcome to the State Library of New South Wales. My name is Susan Hunt and I'm director of the foundation here at the State Library. And it's just wonderful to welcome you here face to face. And also we have an online audience. So welcome. Firstly, I would like to acknowledge the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation and their descendants on whose land this library now stands. And I would like to pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging, and any Aboriginal people here today. Now, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to our special literary series for the Friends of the Library, Reflections in Conversation with Acclaimed Writers. This has been commissioned by the Foundation, which is the major fundraising arm of the library. I know many of you are aware of that, being friends or donors. And we assist the library in sharing and building and conserving our unique collections. And our most recent project is the new conservation labs, which I'm hoping to share with you very soon, and the new map rooms in the Mitchell building, which will open next week. So tonight's talk is the third and the final in our reflection series, which has previously featured writers Robert Drew and Anna Funder discussing the body of their work in conversation with our convener, Nicole Abadee. But tonight I would particularly like to extend a very warm welcome to our award-winning author, Markus Zusak. And we are so, so excited that you're here tonight and you've joined us in person. When we were planning this, we weren't sure that you'd be able to be in person, but we're very, very excited for you to come here and talk to us about your fabulous writing. We are great admirers of your work, Markus, and our bookstore has a number of books available tonight for you to sign and for our guests to purchase. We also have on sale copies of our latest edition of our new library magazine Open Book that you'll see here on the table, which includes a fantastic new short story, The Alarm Clock, that Markus has written for us. We also are very, very pleased that we have Nicole Abadee, our convener here again for the series. She has developed this whole program with us and it's been a very exciting collaboration. Literary consultant, podcaster and writer, Nicole writes for The Good Weekend and has a notable books podcast, Books, 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 where she speaks to Australian and international writers about their latest work. I'm also thrilled to say that she's a judge for the 2021 New South Wales Premier Literary Awards for the Christina Stead Prize for Fiction. So please give a warm welcome to our special guests, Nicole Abadee and Markus Zusak.
Thank you so much, Sue, for that lovely welcome. Well, welcome to the third and final conversation in this three-part series with acclaimed Australian writers. Thank you so much to the State Library of New South Wales Foundation for hosting this series of events. Tonight, I'm absolutely delighted to be here in conversation with Markus Zusak. Before we begin, I too would like to acknowledge the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, the traditional custodians of this land, and pay my respects to their elders past and present. Now I'd like to tell you a little bit about Markus. Markus is the internationally best-selling writer of six novels and one of Australia's best-loved and most successful writers. His books have been translated into more than 50 languages and he's won many awards for his writing, including the 2014 Margaret A. Edwards Award for Lifetime Achievement in Writing for Young Adults. He's probably best known for The Book Thief, which was published in 2005. It has been read by more than 16 million people around the world. It's been voted Australia's favourite book. It spent 10 years on the New York Times bestsellers list. It won the Commonwealth Writers Prize. And in 2013, it was made into a major motion picture. All this for a book that Markus thought at the time he was writing it, nobody would ever read. His next book, Bridge of Clay, which was published in 2019, has also been widely acclaimed and it won the Indie Book Awards Fiction Prize. Now, I read somewhere that Markus likes to imagine interviews as conversations in his kitchen, his favourite room. So Markus, please just relax and pretend that we're here in your kitchen. Markus, you were born in Sydney, the youngest of four children to a German mum and an Austrian dad, both of whom had arrived in Australia in the 1950s, unable to speak or write a word of English. Your mum grew up with no books in the house, so she was determined that her children would love books. How did your parents encourage you to read, and what sort of books were there in the house where you grew up?
Okay, before I answer that, First, I just want to say thank you. What the hell are you doing here? It seems weird that we're all here, and I appreciate it so much. You could be at home watching telly, and I have to pick up. There's an elastic. If I'm supposed to be in my own kitchen, there was an elastic that was driving me crazy. So right there, now I've got to put it down so I don't play with it all night. So thank you very much for coming. It's hugely appreciated, and just that books still matter and stories still matter in the world means the world to me. So thank you for keeping that and us alive. And also to the State Library, I'll get to answer the question and tell me if my time's up. But the State Library has always been really supportive of me long before The Book Thief. Everyone kind of wants to claim, not everyone, but every now and again, there are people who say, oh, I was the first person to read The Book Thief, or I helped that book become successful, but the State Library was there for me long before that. I've always come here, so The Book Thief was my fifth book, and there were four books before that that not many people knew or cared about, but the State Library of New South Wales did, and they always had me come here and talk to young people about books. And so I did a lot of school events here and workshops, and you know, right up to now, I'm really proud to have a story in Open Book, and that's Vanessa Bond's great work. So if you can support it and get it, come straight to your home. So I'm really proud to be a part of that in this issue. So thanks to the State Library as well. To answer your question about books, well, my dad was really fond of the Encyclopedia Britannica, and that doesn't sound very exciting, but I actually bought some for $35 from the Sutherland Library when they were getting rid of them, just for the memory of that, because he would always go and look things up, and that's how we did all our school assignments. You know, it's a long way from looking things up on Wikipedia. On Wikipedia, my dad's name is Joseph. My dad's actual name is Helmut. And so I think Encyclopedia Britannica was more accurate. And I also at one point, so I'm not even answering the question. At one point, I apparently had changed my name from Milos Sivanovrosovich to Markus Zusak. That was also a Wikipedia fact. And so if I was going to change my name, I wouldn't have changed it to Markus Zusak, of all the things. So I remember those books, but we had a bit frowned upon now, but we had every Dr. Seuss book known to man or woman. And there were books I couldn't read. I would just carry them around. And I wasn't that much of a bookish kid. I was more in the backyard. I was always doing things, but I loved reading as well. So there was this idea that, now, I don't want to give people the idea that I was always carrying a book around, and I would chew on the end of books sometimes. And all my books were other people's books, because I was the youngest of four kids. So every book that I ever had my brother's or my sister's names in them before mine. And so it makes it even harder for me to give them away now, because my brother's name is in them. And I kind of love seeing that, even though he was a complete bastard, growing up, and I had to put up with his leftovers and hand-me-downs. But that's what makes you the person, and if you're a writer, the writer that you become.
Markus, you knew from the age of 16 at least that you wanted to be a writer. Why was that? What made you so determined to do that? What appealed to you about that as a career?
I loved reading. I didn't love reading all books. I'm not that big a reader. And I do sort of remember talking earlier today about this, that there's this whole idea that to become a writer, everyone, we always trot out these, I don't want to say cliches, but just sort of landmark things about, hey, you've got to read everything and read widely. And I think that's true, but it's not the only truth. There are other truths that, like for me, I'm not a wide reader. I'm a narrow reader, and I become obsessive about things. And so rather than read three books in a month, I'll read the same book three times.
Over and over.
Yeah. And
why?
Because that's what I love. Mm-hmm. And I want to experience that moment again. And it's like when watching favorite movies, I always like I was a huge fan of Northern Exposure, the TV show, and I've been re-watching it. And there are just certain looks on an actor's face that I will go back and watch 8 times because, and it's not so much, there's a part of me that is deconstructing it and going, how do you do it? Because that's how you become a writer. I mean, I loved S.E. Hinton's novels when I was a teenager. And I, so my first books were just copies of her books. And so I'm learning how to do things by reading the same book over and over again. And again, it was really great. I spoke to an up and coming writer today and it made me really happy. It's made me happier now because it was sort of remembering things that we talked about and how you want your writing, things that make you want to be a writer is when you read something that's got electricity in it and you go, how do I make that electricity? And how do I make it my own electricity? Like how, so you're trying to learn from these people and you, but yet you're trying to write something that only you could have written. And so that's my goal now is I don't want to write better than anybody else. I don't want to be more successful than anyone else really, but I want to write books that only I could have written. And that's easier said than done.
So Markus, you started by writing books for young adults. Your first novel was The Underdog, published in 1999 when you were 24, and it was the first of a trilogy of books about the Wolf Brothers. You then wrote The Messenger, another book for young adults, which was published in 2002. We're going to focus tonight on Markus's two biggest books, the two that you're most well known for, The Book Thief and Bridge of Clay. So let's start with The Book Thief, published in 2005. Can you tell us what that's about? It's the toughest question of the night.
Of course not. It's it is always the hardest question, but I'm not going to go around it too much. Is that you spend the I spent a long time trying to figure out how to describe the book till it was just a long list of everything that I could just think of within a minute that I could write down. But then I finally realized that the way to describe it was to say it's about the idea that in Nazi Germany, Hitler destroyed people with words and propaganda. And it was a book about a girl who was stealing the words back and writing her own story with them. And it's a beautiful story written through this ugly world and about the personal stories we make and the decisions we make that make our lives what they are. And so that to me was what The Book Thief was about, a beautiful story written through an ugly world. And they came on the back of stories that my mum and dad told me as a kid that I asked for over and over and over again, because kids don't get tired of stories. And I don't want to get tired of stories as I get older too. And that's why I try to watch certain films or read certain books year after year after year.
I wanted to ask you about that. I know you said that your first research for that book was really having listened through your childhood to your parents talking about their experiences in Europe during World War II, in Austria and in Germany. What I'm interested in is how did you shape those stories that you'd heard from your parents? How did you craft them and shape them into the fiction, the book, The Book Thief?
You have a lot of false starts when you're writing. It's really hard at these moments where you get a question and like 6 answers come up. I'm trying to get the most concise one.
There are a lot of false starts
where, like, I first started writing The Book Thief, I can still remember where I was. I was in Warrnambool and I'd driven down from somewhere in country Victoria. Actually, I know where, a place called Hopetoun. So I was speaking in high schools to make a living because my books weren't making any money really. And it was a great way to build a career. And I sat down in this motel on a Saturday and I wrote a first chapter and I went, that's not it. So I spent so much of my time going, that's not it. And I start again, I go, that's not it. That's not it. But in each one, there's a crumb that you pick up and you use in the next one. And then, so the first not it moment was that my mum had told me a story about how her foster father came home drunk and wasn't allowed into the house. And so he slept out in the barn and it was so cold that he got stuck to the ground. And so her foster mother came and to wake him up, she just threw a bucket of hot water on him. And that was how the book was going to start. And I thought it would be this 100-page novella about, you know, these little vignettes of this time. Yeah, I didn't know what I was doing. It was originally going to be called, this is, I only realized this a few years ago when I was talking about it, that I thought it was going to be nonfiction. I thought it was going to be about my mum growing up in Nazi Germany. It was just going to be her story. And it was going to be called, because there was a radio show in Munich at the time of the American, where the American soldiers occupied Munich. And so they had a radio program at midday every day, and it was called Luncheon in Munchen, because they didn't know how to say Munich, you know, which the actual pronunciation being München. And so Luncheon, and I was going to, so my great idea was to call this book Luncheon in Munchen. And thank God I didn't go with that. The Book Thief is a bit of a better title. But the title is always very important to me. And it's usually one of the first things I think of. I think of the beginning, often I think of the end, and then I think of the title, and I write to the title. And so when someone says, we're thinking of changing the title, I go, well, I'm going to need a month to rework the book, because the book's written to the title. And not everyone works like that. I've got one of my best friends, she will write a whole book and then she'll go, you got to give me a title. Wow. But that was as far as shaping it. Then I just left it for a while. Then I was writing with some kids at a school, and at lunchtime, I was still sort of part-time teaching, and I had these kids at a school and I got them to write about colours, and I wrote with them. And I realised I'd written about three moments and the colour in the sky at those moments, and there were three deaths, and I'd written from the point of view of death. And I went, maybe I should put that into that book that I'm setting in Nazi Germany. And I had that. I'd also written previously a page of something called The Book Thief about a girl, it was always a girl, stealing a book in modern day Sydney. And I had Nazi Germany, someone stealing books, and then death as narrator. And then as far as shaping it goes, you don't shape to begin with. You hope, you sit down and you write. And I wrote 200 pages really quickly, like in January of, say, 2004, maybe 2003. And then I looked at it in February and went, that's awful, awful. You know, some of it's overwritten. Like, I see real flaws in the book, and where it's overwritten, overdone, the images go a bit too far or whatever. And I still sort of say it was better to go too far with that book than not far enough. It's better. It was just always, it's always like, take the risk.
And Marcus, can I take you back to something that you started by saying, that when you were starting the book, you kept saying, that's not it. How do you know when it is it?
It's usually when I want to keep going. Mm. Because like a lot of writers, I don't usually feel like writing. I sort of have to drag myself to the desk, because you're just riddled with everything that's wrong with you, and that you're not really that good. And how could you ever write as well as Michael Chabon or someone like that, or Sylvia Plath? You go, it's all been done. Why should I do anything? But then there's always something, and this is how you know you're a writer, is that no matter how doubtful you are of yourself, something calls you back and makes you do it. And you realize it's the only thing. Like, I can do so many things that make me happy. I mean, it's pretty exciting, but I'll go home and I'll watch Thursday night football, all right? And that'll make me happy. I can go surfing and that'll make me really happy. I can take my dogs out and make me really happy. I haven't mentioned my children or my wife yet. I realize
that'll make you happy too.
That's at the very top, you know, and that spending time with them makes me really happy. But the only thing that makes me feel like I'm useful, like really useful, is if I write well.
So let's come back to something you mentioned, that you said that you wanted to write books that only you could write. And that's a really nice segue into the next thing I wanted to ask you about, which is your writing style that is really highly original. So you've mentioned, I'll just go through a few of the points and I'll just ask you about a couple, but the narrator is death of this book, The Book Thief. It's narrated by death, and death speaks directly to the reader in the second person quite frequently. You will notice this, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, and now I'm going to take you somewhere else. So that's the first thing that's very distinctive. The structure, I think, is quite distinctive. It's divided into 10 parts, and each part is made up of a number of chapters. And something that you do, which I hadn't really seen before, is you summarize the chapter titles at the beginning of each part. And then there's something else that you do within the chapters. There are short sections that are highlighted in bold. They're in dark font. They've got funny little symbols around them. So, for example, in the middle of, I wrote down part one, chapter one, you've got written suddenly a spectacularly tragic moment or an observation. And then there'll be something in bold. Somewhere else you've got Book Thief Productions officially presents. All of this seems to me to be very, very original. So I want to ask you two things. First of all, let's talk about death as the narrator. How did you make that decision?
Okay. I always start by not answering. But the one that you said, Book Thief Productions presents, I really wish I hadn't done that.
Why? It makes it theatrical.
You know, it was one of those ones where I went too far. It was a bit too far. And the editor, the structural editor, actually said, maybe you should take that out. It's a bit Monty Python. And I sort of went, I really like it. I liked it at the time. I loved it at the time. And I sort of went, yeah, it's got that quirkiness.
It seem theatrical. It makes the whole thing seem
more theatrical. Yeah, a bit over the top.
Doesn't work like that.
You're not going to win this argument,
all
right?
I didn't think about the top
five. But it's one of those things where that's why you write your next book. You write your next book to atone for the sins of the last one. But death as the narrator, it just felt right. And actually, it ties in well with that idea that you said of the interruptions where death will say, here is a small fact, and no, death's diary or whatever. And how that happened was I was reworking, because I'm always reworking. I'm always going back to the beginning and reading my first chapters, which can be, if you overdo it, you just get stuck there. So I don't advise that. But you're always getting to know, it's like any other relationship you have in your life. The most important, you know, top three relationships that I'll have is the one with my book. I want to roll out of bed in the morning and feel like I can land in the world of that book that's close, that I don't have to go and search for it somewhere, for that world. It just needs to be next to me. And so in that case, I was up reworking it. I still remember, again, I can still see this little townhouse that we lived in. It was quite late at night. And I heard the voice in my head saying, you are going to die. And it was actually stolen from Fight Club. And Tyler Durden at one point, and in the film, I don't know, I actually haven't read the book, but he's sort of saying, it's that bit where he's training the army to wreak mayhem on the city. And he's saying, you are not unique. You are not original. You are not a snowflake. You are not special. You are going to die. You are going onto the compost heap. And just that you are going to die, I went, and what I heard, I was just looking at the very beginning. First the colors, then the humans. That's usually how I see things. And then I went, I haven't looked at that. I mean, it's not that hard to remember, but I mean, for all these years later, I can just remember that. And then I heard a voice in my head saying, here is a small fact, you are going to die. And I saw it, heard it in my head, and then I saw it on the page before I wrote it, and it was in the middle. And I just went, there's always a moment in any sort of endeavor, it doesn't matter. I heard an Olympic swimmer talk about his race plan and how he heard a voice in his head at a totally different part of the race saying, go now. Mm-hmm. And that's what made him win the Olympic backstroke in whatever year. And when you hear that voice, it usually comes because you've done all this work. Mm-hmm. You've done all this work, and you suddenly, finally, you know what you're grappling with, but you don't know, you know, and you get given a gift. And then you go, and so I just put it in the middle of the page and I went, that feels right. Mm. And then I wrote a bit more, and then I went, oh, I'm starting to have fun now. And anytime, as soon as I start having fun, that comes back to your original comment about how do you know that's it and that isn't it? Mm. It's because I'm actually starting to enjoy it. I feel like writing is like climbing a mountain. It's really difficult, but there's a sand pit at the top that you get to play in. But the sandpit isn't at the bottom. And that's for very good reasons, because you got to actually have it be useful to you. And all of those things that you talk about that I do that are unusual is when I'm just starting to play.
How do you think of those? I mean, it's a simple thing, but just the little, in the middle of chapters, these little sections in bold that really hold your attention and they really sort of stop you up short as a reader and then you want to read on. How do you think of those things?
There was a time where I was thinking I wanted to make a sort of leap from writing for younger people to adults. And I started trying to use more intellectual words. I remember one in particular, acquiesce. I would never use that word in real life unless it was all, I mean, there's nothing, it's a good word. It's a great word actually, but I would never, and then I wrote it and I went, why are you, it took me a little while to figure it out. I think it was in a John Irving book I'd been reading at the time. And, so I'm just stealing from John Irving now. And then I went, okay, maybe this. Not necessarily too consciously, but I sort of went, you're actually not that. I'm not an intellectual, not really. And I said today, I was encouraged to confess. Well, not confess, but to say, like, I got 77.35 in my HSC, what was it called? It wasn't an ATAR back then, it was something else. And which isn't that great. It's all right. I was pretty good at my school, and which wasn't terrible either. It was a standard middle-class school. And so I went, you're not that guy. Like, yeah, sure, I love the Iliad and the Odyssey, and I love certain, great works of literature, but I'm not that kind of writer. What I realized is you've got a certain pool of words and they're ordinary words, but it's amazing what you can do with a small pool of words by how you arrange them.
We're going to come to talk about your use of language a little bit later. I think that particularly noticeable in Bridge of Clay, there's a few examples, so we'll come back to that. At one point in this book, the Book Thief, Death makes a comment about human beings. Death says that something, proof again of the contradictory human being. So much good, so much evil. Just add water. And we see a great deal in the Book Thief about the human capacity for evil. It's set in Nazi Germany. But we also see acts of incredible courage and of beauty. The most obvious one, of course, being Liesl's foster parents, hiding Max, the young Jewish man, in their home at enormous personal risk. And I wondered, is that one of the main themes, one of the driving sort of concerns of yours in the book, that even in the darkest times, human beings are still capable of acts of great beauty?
I mean, I think that's what it's about, but that's not what I'm searching for. Whenever I'm writing or coming up with trying to see a book, like see it in front of me, I'm just looking for moments. I'm looking for something memorable, something that makes somebody totally go into that moment and be there. And it's why I love movies, but books are my first love, because I feel like movies show you, what's happening, but books makes you see the characters, but books make you the character. You get to be the character, is how I feel, because you're there on your own. And so I'm not trying to teach those lessons. And I don't want to answer this as a sort of that typical thing of, oh, I don't start with a theme or anything like that. But it is true. I just want to make something, I think, that is moving the reader, whether it is in a comedic way or a dramatic way or a tearful way. I want to feel those emotions that I felt that made me want to be a writer. That is all I'm ever trying to do, is I want to perform that magic act of a reader turning the pages and not realizing they're turning pages and that they feel like they're there. I mean, to me, that is such a magical thing. And I know it sounds a bit hokey, but that to me, I mean, it is magic, because they're just words on a page and they're just something that someone's made up. And I love that idea that you are reading, when you're reading a novel, you're reading something that someone has made up, but you believe it when you're in it. Which to lighten that now, I have to say, it's like why I love George in Seinfeld, when he's trying to teach Jerry how to lie. And he says, remember, Jerry, it's not a lie if you believe it. and that is what I'm doing when I'm writing. I'm trying to write so that I believe it. And if I'm not, and again, that's not it, because I don't believe it yet.
Yeah.
And it's when I believe it, that's when it keeps me going.
I'd love to talk a lot longer about The Book Thief, but we're not able to tonight. Let's talk now about Bridge of Clay, which was published in 2019. You first started thinking about this book when you were 20, and you started making notes for it in 2005, the year that The Book Thief had been published. What's this one about, Markus?
Well, I'll just go for, I'm not going to tell you anything about anything that's in the book, but I think what that book is about in its story and in the writing of it is it sort of teaches its own lesson to me anyway, which is that we can always try to, it was about someone trying to reach for greatness, knowing that in this case, he can't actually be great, but going for it anyway. And that's what's great. Mm. That's what that book is about, knowing that you are flawed and you can't actually create something totally perfect and beautiful, but you have to try anyway. And the beauty is actually in the attempt. That's what Bridge of Clay is really about.
You worked away at it for many years, having started, you really started making the notes in 2005. And in 2016, you were still working on it 10 years later. And your wife said to you something to the effect of, it's been a decade. I think you and Clay need a break. I'm giving you 1 week. And you say that she wasn't giving you a week to finish it, but a week to feel happy about the writing process again. So you took 6 weeks off and then you returned to it. You say to your wife in the acknowledgements in Bridge of Clay, thanks for showing me what life would be like without finishing it. Markus, what I'm interested in is what happened in those 6 weeks? What made you return to it?
Well, the truth is I was always going to return to it, and I was just lying to everyone that I was going to stop, because that's what you do when you have obsessions. Like, no one can really stop you. And I think it was just, I think what happens is, and this is what I encourage anyone out there who's trying to write, and especially someone who's trying to write a novel, is you've usually done more work than you think you have. So I just thought this was a ruin, this book. You know, it was just, I'd basically done 97% of the work, and I'd written, 80% of the book. And it was just like, okay, just, you know, pull yourself together, man, and stop being so precious. And what I ended up doing was saying, right, just bring it. Everything is actually really quite simple, no matter how complex your book is or how many characters there are. And you know, I had a lot of characters, had a lot of animals, time frames that were different. But at the end of the day, all the problems are simple and they have simple solutions. You've just got to do them one at a time. And so I went, let's bring this back to a whole new criteria. The new criteria is this bit alive or is it dead? If it's dead, okay, if it's alive, keep it. If it's dead, get rid of it or bring it to life in a real hurry. And one of the things that I kept having to teach myself with that book was that there were times where I was trying to get the reader to fall in love with a character, for example. Like, there was the character of Carrie, who was almost like a Rudy Steiner character in that book, like Rudy from The Book Thief, whereas I wanted people to love Carrie, but it was a whole different thing. It wasn't a charismatic relationship between her and Clay. It was a very private thing. And then I thought, you know what the problem with her is that I keep describing her. She has to do something. Because I fell in love with Rudy as a character the moment he decided he wanted to become Jesse Owens.
Yes.
He did something. And so I was like, okay, make her rough. And I had all these other problems. God, I had some problems with that book.
Let's stop you for a second. Before we talk a little more about Kerry, can we just go back a step and tell us a bit about the Dunbar family and mm-hmm. about Clay in particular? Tell us about this family that you created.
Well, so it was a family of, okay, mum has come from communist Poland to Australia and left her dad behind because he sent her and wanted her to have a better life. And then a dad who'd been married before, and they have these five boys. And so I was always walking this tightrope of five rumbunctious sort of boys. And it was chaos control. It was like a Kandinsky sort of idea. And so I was always in trouble, just always. I remember, like, I love Wonder Boys, the Michael Chabon book and film, where there's this writer just in deep trouble. And I used to watch that film and read the book to comfort myself, to sort of go, well, at least I haven't got it as bad as that guy. And then there was a tipping point where I went, actually, I'm in more trouble than Grady is. And so there was always this family, and these boys ended up having a mule, a border collie, a goldfish called Agamemnon.
This is the Dunbar boys.
Yeah, the Dunbar boys. Yeah. A goldfish called Agamemnon. You know, the mule's name was Achilles. And so I was always playing with this absurdity, and yet there was such discipline in the writing. And so there was so much going on. And the way I differentiate the two books is that, you know, the Book Thief just feels like I just sat down, scratched my, you know, leg or whatever, and just wrote it, and it was easy. And whereas Bridge of Clay, I think you can feel the effort, and it suited Clay because Clay is he's carrying that family and its past on his shoulders.
And he's the fourth son.
And he's the fourth Dunbar boy. And he's the one who has to kind of reconcile, because their dad has left them after their mother's death. And he's the one who brings them back together. And yet he's the silent one. But he was the one who loved stories. So he's the one who knows how to bring their father and his four brothers back together. And, you know, it only takes 500 odd pages. And it really, you know.
And I interrupted you. I'm sorry. You were talking about Carey, but I just wanted to, put that. So
Carey, people know what I'm talking about every now and again.
So young Clay, when he's 15, 16, he meets Carey, who's girl next door, almost literally the girl next door, and a romance starts between them. And you were talking about Carey and her character.
Well, and it's funny too, sorry if I say that a lot. It's funny. It's a bad habit. But I'm attracted when I talk about those moments, it's also like I'm often attracted to just a line in a book. And when Carey first moves in across the road, she stops and she's holding the toaster and the cords hanging down, and she stops and she looks over and she says, look, there's a boy up there on that roof. And so in a way, I'll write a whole chapter around that line because I like the line. And it's funny, in the editing of the book, again, for anyone out there writing, and it's good, don't try this too early on in your relationship with an editor or a publisher, but there'll be a certain line, and it's one of those absurdities where I'll write something that seemingly doesn't make sense, or it's the wrong word in the wrong place, but it's exactly how I want it to be. I'm trying to think of an example. And the editor, I remember getting the edit, and in the margin it said, I think maybe you should cut that out, like change that, you know, to something that actually makes sense. And I remember writing back, I know this is only page 8, but I just want to make it clear about this line, is that I'll let a lot of things go, and I'm very agreeable generally, but just so you're clear, I would rather cut off one of my fingers than take that line out of the book.
So I think
Understood.
I was going to say, I think I've picked some of those out. I've got a note that your use of language is so unique. You know, it's quirky and it's wonderful. So just some of the examples I've written down, you talk about the perfection of brothers. So you're using perfection as a collective noun for the five brothers. Carey has, I'm not even going to say this, but probably garrulous hair. I mean, who has garrulous hair? And the family, at one point you call them, the family is a porridge of mess and fighting. How do you do that? When we read that, we know exactly what you mean. Nobody else would have picked perfection as a collective noun to describe a bunch of brothers. How do you nail that word?
That one I wasn't, the perfection of brothers, I probably didn't even know that was improper. Because I'm not really a grammar student. I grew up at a time where grammar wasn't even taught in high school. And so, I mean, I understand why that something's wrong, but I often don't know why in a sentence. But the garrulous hair is a good example. To me, it just makes perfect sense, and that's why I'm always saying to people, it doesn't have to make sense at the top level. It can make sense somewhere way, way down, and you know it's the right word. There was an example I'm trying to think of with, there's Penelope. There's a point where It's one of my favorites. It was one of the things that resurrected the book, the chapter called Growing Up the Dunbar Way.
Penelope's the mum.
Yeah, it's the second chapter in part five where Rory, the really tough and rugged brother, spills his soup down his shirt, his dinner. And so they make him eat dinner without his shirt on. And then when all the other boys laugh, they make them all take their shirt off at dinner. And to me, it was just a really comic moment. And then their dad takes his shirt off to have dinner. And then Penny, the mum, because she's always, she seems like a bird, you know, that you can't harm. But then she's tough enough to kind of take her shirt off during dinner.
Yes.
And there's a description of her underwear. And it was always, I couldn't get that word. And so how do I come up with garrulous hair? Sometimes it's instant and I have it straight away. But sometimes I put a word in and I go, that's not the word. It's too conventional, or I don't like it, or I don't, you know, or I have a relationship with it, like acquiesce or whatever, and I just don't want to use it. And in that case, day after day, I'd put a new word in. I'd go, nah, that's not it. That's not it. And I think it ended up being a sentence like, you know, her bra was something and scruffy.
Yeah.
And as soon as I woke up in the morning and I went, scruffy. And what that did was it summed up for me. So what I'm trying to do is that thing of, you hear sometimes about what does a novel do? It shows you a world that you don't know and yet reminds you completely of your own world.
Mm.
And so for me, that sent me reeling back to being a kid and looking at our clothesline. There were six of us and there was always shitty underwear on the clothesline. And when I used the word scruffy, I saw that clothesline and I went, that's why it's the right word.
Okay, let's move from scruffy to the classics. And you talked a little bit before about the Iliad and the Odyssey, but it's particularly noticeable in Bridge of Clay. There's many, many references because these are Penny's beloved. She's got this love of the classics from her father. She brings these books with her. She absolutely loves the Iliad and the Odyssey. And there's many references throughout the book when she's ill, of her reading to the boys reading to her, her husband reading to her. So there's a lot of references throughout the book to the Iliad and to the Odyssey. And it seemed a bit to me that the building of the bridge itself was a bit like a heroic quest, the sort of thing that Homer might have come up with for one of his characters. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the influence of the classics on your writing.
Yeah, and I think it's really important to go, like, this could be a moment where I start to tell you how much I love the Iliad and the Odyssey and how great they are. But no, that's not it. I loved Homer's use of nicknames.
Mm.
That was the beginning and almost the end. I've struggled through the Iliad, let me be honest, it's tough. And the Odyssey, less so. And it is great though. Like, it's one of those, it's a bit like going, doing something kind of arduous that is really rewarding then. You know, in the same way that we don't eat kind of vegetables every single day for all the time. Like, you know, there's real literature that's good for you and literature that's just fun. But I love the way it was always the fast running Achilles, or, you know, the nimble witted Odysseus. And I'm starting to lose them now. Laughter loving Aphrodite. And I just loved it. And particularly Tamer of Horses, you know, and I'd latch onto something and go, God, I love that. Because I think all cultures love nicknames. And so for me, I just sort of, that to me was just these boys. And so that's why all the boys had these nicknames, you know, like Rory was the human ball and chain. I mean, and it's another ridiculous image, but it just suited him. And then I made it work in the story where he was the one that Clay could never shake in his training. These monumental trainings where I always thought, you know, so I came up with this training method for Clay, which was sort of Olympic in its, you know, from its outset, where he said, where Rory, and I wanted that line again, that memorable line where Rory says to Matthew, you're training him wrong. You're running with him. If you want to get him to run faster, you've got to try to stop him.
Mm-hmm.
And that, like that, and then to me, that was everything about writing as well, is that you've got to put things in front of yourself that make it hard, because that's where your imagination is. And that's how they get Clay to run faster.
Let's talk a little bit about writing generally. One of the things that's very noticeable in your writing, we've touched on it a little bit, is that your writing has such a beautiful rhythm to it. And a lot of it is actually sounds quite poetic if you read it. So just the couple that I picked out from Bridge of Clay. Our mother was dead. Our father had fled. I mean, how's that for a plot summary in one line? You describe them as a family of ramshackle tragedy. I read that you read your writing aloud to yourself as you edit. And I wondered if you could talk to us about how important the sound of the words is to you.
Well, it's funny, you talked about my wife and her telling me I needed to break up with Clay. She often says to me, like if I'm working and we both work together at home, she's not a writer, thankfully. Usually writing couples are insufferable. She says she knows that my writing's going well when she can hear me mumbling. And I really love that. I'm always just reading through and reciting really to myself. And I just thought,
you hear the rhythm of the language.
Yeah, and it just makes it maybe more real, and it makes me do it. It becomes a physical thing more than, and sometimes I think I should actually edit more, not aloud, so that it's more like how a reader reads. But then I can't make myself do it. So it just to me, it makes it a bit more, I think it just makes it a bit more physical. And I tend to I don't like generally, like I like doing things, you know, so I like being busy, like out in the yard and like, I mean, don't think I've got a really nice garden or anything. It's pretty horrendous, but I'm always working on something, and I like cleaning. I think it's important to sometimes divulge a bit too much, like, you know, where people shouldn't have, but I actually pay
in the kitchen.
Remember? Yeah. I pay myself to clean the house because I think, yeah, because I think, yeah, I reckon that's worth it. And my mum was a house cleaner, and I used to hate the sound, and I used to hate the sound of her vacuuming our house when I was a kid, and especially when I was starting to want to be a writer. Because I thought, this is just a fancy, you know, that you're sitting here trying to write books. I mean, who the hell do you think you are? And your mum's vacuuming the hallway. Yeah. And so I have this thing about sort of work ethic a little bit. And so I think reading aloud makes it that little bit more work and more noticeable.
Markus, in 2014, you gave a TED talk called The Failurist. And in it, you said that the best advice you can give aspiring writers is don't be afraid to fail, as failure has been your best friend as a writer. Would you like to talk a bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, it's stolen straight from Samuel Beckett, you know, fail again, fail better. It was one of his famous quotes. And I just think, when you're a writer, it's the easiest job in the world to still not do. And so you're being tested all the time how much you want it. And that's what your failures are doing. They're saying, how much do you really want to do this? Do you really want to do it? Or are you just kidding around here? And so I think that's one of the big ones, but it's also where your imagination.
But like when you told us with Bridge of Clay, you always knew you were going to keep at it. Even after a decade when your wife said, go away, come back, you always knew you were going to finish that.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know I was going to finish it. But I knew I was going to keep working on it. and no matter what it did to me, because I was too far gone to start something new. I was like, how can I start? I couldn't write something quickly. It was sort of, yeah. So, I feel like it is like the old cliche that, you know, necessity is the mother of invention, is that you have this fact, if something's not working, so you've got to find a way around it. Or you have to imagine your way around it. And that's, you know, like we're even in The Book Thief, where, you know, death didn't work as a really sardonic, you know, harsh narrator. And then so I had Liesl as the narrator herself, and that didn't work. So another failure, so-called failure there, I had to get around. And so find my way around, the way I imagined my way around it, was just sort of going, oh, what if death is actually afraid of humans? And it was sort of all powerful minus with that little chink. I went, that's how you do it. So that's the other thing too, is you always think you have to make drastic changes. When you've done the work and you've done a whole lot of work and you've done your 97%, you realize your changes don't have to be drastic. They just need to be little things. And it's often those little things that make it yours. So that's where I think your failures are useful. They push you to imagine harder.
Now's the opportunity for people in the audience to ask Markus questions. I think there's going to be a microphone floating around. And if you, oh, sorry.
You can also call out.
Sorry,
yeah,
no
call
microphone.
Out and so I'll repeat the question.
Yes, terrific. So if you put your hand up if you've got a question. Don't worry, I've got lots more if nobody does have, but I'd like to give you a chance. Sue.
Okay, so the question was, after a book that's an unexpected success, like The Book Thief, how do you even begin something else? I think it's hard no matter what. And I think one of the big things to remind yourself of in that situation is that what comes in through the door, like the door opens really wide and all this great light comes in, but then this little bit of darkness comes in with it. It has to. And they're your negative reviews. They're your one-star reviews on Amazon. They're the people who don't like you. Mm-hmm. They're the people who think you're a hack. They're the ones who say, this is just like bad university writing in a creative writing class and so on. And then, you know, and then your book, you know, is number two on, you know, the top 10, you know, sort of in a vote, you know, that's on national TV on the ABC, and then the critics bag the shit out of it. And you sit there and you're 3-4 years into your next book and you go, it might take a month to recover. And I'm serious, that's true. It took me a month to recover from getting belted around. I mean, I was lucky it wasn't number one. They would have hung me from the rafters in the ABC. And I say that. I don't say that bitterly. It's just a fact, you know, and often, you know, and you can sit there and go, well, where's your book? Where's your New York Times bestseller? Mm-hmm. And then you just sort of go, but that's just silly. You know, everyone has a job to do. Everyone's looking after themselves. Everyone's looking after their own reputation. And at the end of the day, the voice sort of calls you to go back to work. And then you start writing and hoping. And it's no different. That's when I know that I'm ready to be back at work, is when I don't care anymore what anyone thinks. And I don't care about whatever critics and the people who say good things, even the people who say great things about you and love you, you know, they don't really love you. But, you know, that's for your family and for everyone else. So you have to write that next book for yourself, and you have to be selfish and you have to guard it and, you know, be open and share and talk about it if that's your nature, which is mine in general, but also just say, right, cut all that out. It's just you and your characters and you love them. And that's why, and the last thing I'll say about that is when I read through Bridge of Clay with a really trusted friend of mine, and I was just really bawling at the end, and she said, who is that in your real life? Who is that that you're writing about? And I said to her, I didn't say, don't you get it? But that's what I thought. Not in a mean way, but I just went, it's them. They're real to me. That's who I'm crying for as I read this. Even though I know they're not real, it's for them. That when you're writing the book for the people in the book, that's when you know it's working.
Yes.
50 years ago,
yeah, right. Thank you. There I was thinking Zusak was a terrible name at the very bottom. And there are cases of authors who change their name so that it's at eye level. And the one thing I'll say is, well, and it just struck me, is that The Thornbirds doesn't have it, except it's in Colleen McCulloch.
Yes.
Plenty of time. So there you go. Thank you.
Literature.
Oh, that's a, but it's a great book still, I think.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes, right up the back.
Can you just shout it
yeah,
out?
Yeah, we can.
That's okay. Neither is my brother.
Hey, that's a big question. I don't know that we can get through all of that.
I can answer it. Okay, so it's about the way books are used in high schools, and if it's a good thing and so on, and how they're being analysed. I'll be quick on one hand and say I think I really love it when my books are used in schools, and I know that some kids are going to go, ah, bloody hell, I've got to read this 580-page book. But I love that some books are introduced to kids. Maybe this is the best way to answer this, is I had to read Catch-22 when I was in year 11. I couldn't get through the first two chapters. Mind you, I wasn't the greatest high school student. But I asked for it for my 21st birthday, and then I read it and I loved it. So what I firstly love is that high school kids are exposed to books, and teachers run that risk of kids hating the book at the time, but then discovering it later. And I think that's really courageous. As for the analysing, I don't think it hurts. And, you know, and I've got a 14-year-old daughter and a 10-year-old son, and I don't mind the fact that, I mean, I know a lot of people who love 1984 because they studied it in their HSC year.
I'm one
and,
of those.
Yeah, and, yeah, and people who, they'll talk about their love of Shakespeare, and, you know, and half the time they've only, it's just one play, but it's because they studied it. And I think the, you know, things can be overanalyzed, but I think in general it's a good thing. I'd rather things probably be overanalyzed than underanalyzed, and if people are finding meanings in the books that aren't there, I think that only sort of speaks to the levels that are in the book. So I'm more than happy for people to find things in my books that I didn't necessarily intend, because maybe I did intend them at a subconscious level.
Any other questions? Yes.
I love the depiction of these sort of five wild and gentle brothers.
The question's about Bridge of Clay, and was it always going to be five brothers? And way, way, way back, there was a brother, there were two brothers and a sister. This is back in, I read a draft of this. I wrote Bridge of Clay in a totally different way back in about 1997. I wasn't published yet, and I realised that wasn't the book. And then later on, then it was going to be three brothers. And then I just sort of went, five sounds right. And I just needed a trait for each of them. And there was the one who loved the pets, and there was Clay. And so far, as soon as it just seemed right, and I wanted to bet big, like there's a time, you know, and all the time I'm sort of going, like I tried to write a really short book last year, and then I was just disinterested. And so there's a point all the time where I'm going, just bet everything, like Death as Narrator, bet it all, you know, take everything you've got, put it there and bet, and you can go down in flames, or you can win it all. And there are people who sort of go, oh, Bridge of Clay, geez, the book thief was such a joy, and they can't, they really struggle with Bridge of Clay. And that's why I appreciate your question, because, you know, I often say to people who've read the book and then we'll say something nice about it or whatever, and I say it's not a book for weaklings. Yeah, you've got to be willing to spend time with. Thank you. I think, and so it's, and that's kind of okay too, where you have a writer who has a big success. You know, I mean, look at John Irving's a good example, where I love his novels, and The World According to Garp is his really big one. But then some of the lesser known ones are these sort of hidden gems that are just as lovable in a lot of ways, but you've got to do different work. And so, but yeah, there's a point in every book where you have to take a certain gamble. And I think the book is usually better for that gamble being in it. So yeah, that's why I went with Five Brothers.
Thank you. Markus, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. There'll be an opportunity for those who would like to, who don't already own these fabulous books, to go and buy them tonight, and Markus will sign them. So thank you all for coming. And again, a big thank you to the State Library Foundation.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nicole.
Thank you so much for coming. And there are opportunities for signing books and purchasing books. And it's wonderful to see you all here tonight. And thank you again to our very, very special guests.
Thanks, Nicole. Thank you. Thank you.